Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of Cue It Up with the Q Brothers.
That's us.
Us, as always. So we tried,
My name is Ralph Quattrucci.
Well, I did say your name, Ralph, but yes, it is Ralph, and I'm John Quattrucci. So, Ralph, we tried the grand experiment 2 weeks ago.
The 10-minute trial?
And it failed miserably. The people who watched it and listened to it liked it, but not too many people did. So I don't know if this one will be an hour. It's definitely not going to be 10 minutes. Hey, you know what? We'll just go on and
What do you think? What's the analytics saying? Why are we losing our fans?
I don't know. Maybe we're boring people. Maybe we're talking about much family stuff. I'm not going to lie.
I'm kind of bored by it, but I enjoy it.
Well,
maybe that's showing.
If you're bored with it, then it's probably going to be reflective of the podcast.
No, I enjoy these. I'm kidding.
That's probably why people are turning it off, because you're bored. I'm not. I love this.
Our big fan, Debbie from our other podcast, she is always big listening. Fan. So,
Mom, Dad, big fans.
Big fans.
They haven't subscribed, though, which is,
Do they know how to?
No, but, okay, you know, I figured they'd figure it out. And, you know, our audience might be small, but they're loyal. So subscribe, hit the notification button, and share it. There might be some other people that like it. So, Ralph, before we get into our topic, what's been going on in the week for you? I think a lot, from what I understand. Would you like to share it with us?
Sure. I'll share it. I've been working on my big National Geographic show. So I have been watching a lot of television. Two things. So we're doing, it was a one-hour show called 20 Animals That Might Kill You. Okay.
That's the title.
Yeah. So it's literally a countdown from 20 down to
obviously. So number one is the most likely to kill you?
The most kills in the United States.
Wow.
Don't give it away. I think I've told you at one point, can't give it away because we don't want to spoil the fun. But we're getting up to the point where I was going to deliver the first rough cut. And my producer decided that this is so good, let's now make it a 2 hour. So we broke it now up into 2 1-hour chunks, top 10.
Oh, I see.
So I went from a 1 hour cut ready to go that was 25 minutes too long. So all we had to do was cut it down for the hour. Now I was up to two 1 hours that we're short on. So we had to add more content in. So I've been obsessing about that.
So you had to take the 1 hour broadcast that you already did.
Yeah, because it's a list, right? It was 20 animals. So all we had to do was chop it right in the middle and go, okay, let's do the first 10 and the second 10. And, you know,
but you're going to add a lot more footage to fill the hour, right?
That's right. But from a network perspective, if we can get people to watch 2 1-hours instead of 1 1-hour, it's a win-win, right?
Yeah.
And all the muckety-mucks said, hey, this thing's going well. Let's now make it 2. And they might actually make it a series, which is a good thing for me and for the producers and anybody working on it.
Just break the list up into fives or something?
No, I think it'll be 10. 10 will be the, you know, 10 most. So what they'll do is things like 10 Amazon animals that will kill you, or 10, you know, whatever it is. I think this is a list of animals that might kill you based on numbers in the United States. But, you know, we'll see. And we have two National Geographic hosts are in it, people who do other shows on National Geographic. So they're kind of integrated through it. So it's been fun. Plus, I'm still in the rabbit hole in that damn documentary about the murder in Colorado. And I'm obsessing about it. And I'm turning into one of those people that's finding. So it's about the guy who strangled his wife and his two kids. Well, I just saw a video yesterday where he's on camera holding the dog and his wife turns and says, "Don't choke the dog." And I felt like I was the first one that saw that. Meanwhile, it's been so. I'm losing my. That's a COVID brain thing.
Oh yeah.
So yeah. Anyway, what about you?
Whoa! You. I mean, that was one thing. But, how was your weekend?
It was very nice. I had my. It was my birthday weekend.
It was your birthday, and what'd you do on your birthday weekend?
Well, Saturday, you know, I did the quinceañera. Do I have to do that again?
You were a big hit at that thing.
It turns out when you're as old as I am and you can still dance, the Spanish ladies love you. All of them, young and old, didn't care. it was kind of weird because we had to be, you know, we had to wear masks and all that. And that was difficult.
Did everyone wear the masks?
Yes. And that was difficult. The heart's going. I mean, it's just
dancing in a mask must have been tough.
And that was it. So we did that, and that was a good Saturday.
Now, so you're how old are you, by the way, on your birthday?
59.
59. So Ralph is seeing somebody new, relatively new, and she reached Maria, and she reached out to me. I never spoke to her or anything, but she messaged me, I think through Facebook, Instant Messenger, and she was getting Ralph pizza. And as you can see behind him, the town spa box, she wanted to know what kind of pizza he liked beyond the hamburg pizza. And I thought, wow, that's pretty thoughtful of this young lady. And I think she bought, what, three? How many she got? Had them delivered to you?
She got three pies, two hamburg, one plain.
And you had a little pizza night with her?
Well, we had, I shared one.
And did she like the pizza, by the way?
Well, I think she had to, I have no idea. I have no idea. Yeah, she enjoyed it, but I don't think.
You know, didn't even ask her? This is your favorite.
I did. But I said, look, I know this is a pizza I grew up with. There's no way I know what it is. It's not, it's like in my DNA. So I think it's great. But most people who have never been there go, it's like eating paper. I don't understand what the big deal is. So, but she was thoughtful. She enjoyed it with me. And then I get to keep the other two for myself. So
I was very impressed with that, I have to tell you. So that's nice that she did that. As far as my week, well, Monday, of course, it relates to golf. The weather here, we had 75 degree weather on Monday. So we golfed and it was just spectacular. It was like golfing in the summertime. Mm. That was great. So then, so 2 days ago, it's so nice out. I'm going to drop my roof. I have a convertible, 2008, BMW convertible, beautiful car. I love this car. So I open the roof up and it doesn't open all the way. It opens, the roof is completely open, but it doesn't go into the back all the way. It's sticking up a little bit. Now I can't open it. I can't close it. It won't do anything. And I've never had a problem with this car. So I bring it to the BMW dealership and they say, we can fix it. Fine, fine, fine. I said, well, do it up and do a check, whatever you do. So then they call me and say, it'll be ready the next day. I go to pick it up. They hand me the bill and it was $2,100.
Well, that's what you get for having a BMW.
And I was like, wow.
Did they not call you before that?
No. I just told them
they
to do the
work. They just assume if you're dropping it off, you can afford it. So
I had no idea. No idea. It would have been that expensive. I figured $600. So it's funny because I just got a job for the first time in a long time. And, you know, I put some of that money in the bank and I was feeling pretty good about myself. And a big chunk of that money just paid for my car. So that was kind of sad. My car is beautiful.
You know, honestly, let's be honest. That's a first world problem. The week you're golfing, 70 degree weather, you bring your BMW in, cost you $2,100. Okay.
It still broke my heart.
I know.
Well, my car's only got,
you know, BMW. You know what that means, BMW.
It means you're cool.
It means break my windows.
No. No. Not at all. People, in fact, somebody said to me when I had the top down the other day, because remember, it's a 2008, but it's only got 51,000 miles on it. It looks beautiful. The guy says, hey, nice ride. And I was like,
well, you know my famous BMW joke, right?
No. Why would you make a joke about a BMW?
Well, what's the difference between a BMW and a porcupine?
Something about pricks. Am I right?
Yeah, on a porcupine, the pricks are on the outside. That's the joke. Okay. But I'll do it on my new.
There's a guy who drove.
I can do that. I can do a rim shot.
Wait a minute. Rim shot. Can you hear that?
I can do it on my new drum kit.
So anyway, that was my week. So here's what I wanted to do.
Wait. I got to ask you a question. Did you see the guy in the Masters drop that hole in one skipping off the water?
Yeah, he did it, but it was in practice. It wasn't
practice,
in the tournament,
but still, right? I mean, he hit a hole in one off the water, skipping off the water.
Yeah, I got my first hole in one this year. So 2020 has been the worst year in the history of the universe.
Right.
But I got a hole in one.
So that makes everything okay.
No, it doesn't make everything
okay. Wait a minute.
Okay.
Do those guys practice that skipping off the water thing?
Yeah, that was just a trick shot. But he wasn't trying to get a hole in one.
No, but he was just trying to skip it off the water.
Yeah. They do that in the practice rounds. Yeah. So anyway, so what I wanted to do this week, because it's funny. The more we do our other podcasts, the more I realize we both love movies, but it's amazing to me how on the opposite end of the spectrums we are as far as what we like.
Completely.
So here's what I wanted to do. I want to pick a genre that you really love. And then I want you to tell me, give me three movies from that genre that an audience, if you really want to get this genre, you want to watch these movies. And if I know any movies from that genre, I will give you what I think. And then I'm going to give you my category. And we might do this a few times as we go forward, because I think it's kind of interesting to understand your thinking about why you like a genre over or another one, or why I prefer some movies over others. So I want to start. Is there a genre out there, your number one genre, that these are the movies you like, and tell me why first?
All right. Well, I'm not going to go. I've been thinking about this because genre. So horror movies or crime movies or whatever. I'm going to, the kind of movie I love, the genre is financial movies, movies about finances. Because as you know, I don't know dick about finances, right?
Well, I am like, you could knock me over with a feather. Out of all the categories I thought you'd pick, that
I can I can barely balance a checkbook. I don't care about money. I just keep it coming in so I can keep doing what I like to do. I don't think about future. I mean, it's crazy that this is, but I don't care if it's a documentary or mainstream film. So things like Wall Street, obviously.
Right.
That's what I was gonna say. There's one on HBO.
Why?
Why Wall Street?
No. Why finance?
Something about when they break down all the stuff, because I have no clue what's going on, what they're talking about. So it's movies like Wall Street. There's a movie on HBO called Too Big to Fail about the 2008 housing crisis.
Yeah.
The movie with Steve Carell. I lost it. What's that one called?
I don't know. I know which one you're talking
about. I'll get it. I'll look it up. And Enron, there's an Enron documentary done by Alex Gibney where he breaks down what happened. And there's something about not understanding the finances that just keeps me, I'm fascinated. And as a matter of fact, the one called Too Big to Fail, the HBO film, it's one of those movies that I watch all the time. It's like it's comfort food for me. And Wall Street, when they're going through all the stock stuff. And there's another one called Margin Call with Zachary Quinto.
Yeah.
Which is fantastic. Kevin Spacey, Zachary Quinto, where, again, it's a housing crisis. It's a 2008 crisis where the whole system's going to break down. There's just something, I can't explain it because I don't understand any of it, right? I can't figure out stocks and all that. I can't figure what's going on, but I'm fascinated by the films. And it's just one of those things. What's the one with Carell? You don't know that one?
I don't know the name of it.
Oh, I can't believe it. It's people are going to laugh because it's ridiculously simple. But
well, how many times have you seen it?
A bunch. But you know, once I tell the light comes on, I forget stuff. So, but yeah, I mean, if you break down, Margin Call, I watch a ton. The Enron
Boiler
documentary.
Have you seen Boiler Room?
Yes. Another one. Boiler Room is great.
And The Wolf of Wall Street.
Wolf of Wall Street.
I love The Wolf of Wall Street.
The Big Short. Come on, it's ridiculous. How could I not remember that? And again, I have no clue what's happening when they're talking about all that stuff, but I love them. It's this crazy thing. And I'm starting to realize, like with this crime stuff that I'm watching and getting obsessed on, that there's details. There's something about the details that just keeps me interested. Like that, the one that the Too Big to Fail, that stars William Hurt and a whole bunch of people. And it's just, I'm fascinated by how things work out there that I don't understand. So it's crazy.
I'm thinking in my head of all the categories you pick. So I'm thinking of all these movies. Never in a billion years would I thought you would have picked that. I mean, I love Wall Street. I think that's a really good movie. Oh, I love Wolf of Wall Street.
Good one.
I liked Boiler Room, but I don't. I mean, I can't really say I've seen a ton of movies based on world.
I assume you've seen The Big Short, right?
No.
You haven't seen The Big Short?
No.
The fun thing about that one is they use actors. I mean, they're using actors, but they break away and they explain what the comp, like they explain stocks by using blackjack, and somebody will explain blackjack, or they'll have Margot Robbie in a bathtub with bubbles and champagne explaining some complicated thing that the only way you're going to watch it is because Margot Robbie's explaining what it means, what a derivative is, and all this stuff. It's just fascinating to me.
Well, a movie I really liked, I don't know if it's finance, but The Informant with Matt Damon.
I never saw that.
Oh my God. It's great. And it's funny and it's based on a true story.
Right.
But it's really, really quirky. I mean, but it's a good movie. It's about how he scammed everybody.
Yeah.
He's so good. He's so good in it too. But right. Yeah. Wow.
What do you expect me to say? Like horror? What do you expect?
Well, no, I figured any movie about a serial killer.
Well,
one I thought for sure that you would pick.
No, when you mentioned it, this is what we're going to talk about. The money thing, I just realized that how many times I just put this stuff on and I'm fascinated. Like Wall Street.
Because you don't know anything about it.
I mean, that might have something to do with it. I'm not learning anything by watching. Like the Enron thing is fascinating to watch how what they were doing to manipulate the stocks and how he broke all that down. The Big Short breaks down what was going on in the housing crisis. And then Too Big to Fail shows you the from the government side of what was going on for them, you know, how they had to try to save the financial situation using all the big banks and all that stuff. Right. And I don't know. Those are movies that I can put on. And for some reason, the endorphins go. And again, I'm not a stock guy, so I'm not even learning to make money.
So what's the one that if someone who maybe is not into those movies, what's the one that you would say, this is the one you should watch?
Boiler Room.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I think Boiler Room is fantastic.
And that's Ben Affleck?
Ben Affleck plays sort of... Oh, Glengarry Glen Ross. I forgot about that one, too.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So Ben Affleck is playing the Alec Baldwin character from Glengarry Glen Ross. And Giovanni Ribisi is a young kid who's a genius with money and stuff, and he starts getting into penny stocks. That is the companion to The Wolf of Wall Street, because that's what that guy was doing.
Right.
And Boiler Room came out before that. And the guy from That Thing You Do, Tom
Everett Scott,
played basically Jordan Belfort. He played what Leonardo DiCaprio was playing. So it's kind of a nice, those are nice companion movies to put together. But Boiler Room has a real gritty feel. Vin Diesel's in there before he hit it big with the car movies he was doing.
The car movies.
Fast and the Furious.
That's good.
But it's fantastic because it really breaks down how that stuff worked. And anyway, that's my thing.
I'm definitely taken aback. I haven't watched enough of those movies to make a big recommendation, but I will tell you that I love The Wolf of Wall Street. I love the way it's made, and DiCaprio's great in it. Jonah Hill's great in it. Margot Robbie's great in it. It's just a funny movie. All the scenes where he's, you know, he's drugged out, and then they replay the scene the way it actually happened is hilarious to me.
No, that's a good one. But you know what? The Boiler Room is kind of the more, I don't want to say serious take on that.
No, it's probably truer than.
Well, I think. Well, what was happening in Wall Street? That stuff happened. That guy flew the helicopter in his backyard.
They played it really over the top.
Well, they did because you got Leonardo DiCaprio and Jonah Hill doing that stuff. And I like the FBI agent in that. He was great.
Yeah.
Kyle, whatever his name is.
The guy from Friday Night Lights.
Yep.
C-Core?
Wasn't he also Rocketeer? No, that wasn't Rocketeer.
No, that's Bill Campbell.
Campbell, right.
A Rocketeer.
But Wall Street's another one that I could watch over and over and over.
Well, because frankly, the performances were so good.
Well, the elevator scene with Martin Sheen.
No, what I see is a jealous old machinist who can't stand the fact that his son's become more successful than he has. What you see is a guy who never measured a man's success by the size of his wallet. That's because you never had the guts to go out into the world and stake your own claim.
That's a ringtone I use.
We quote Steve and a bunch of his buddies. They quote lines from that movie all the time, and that's the one they always say.
Well, Boiler Room. Remember? Have you seen Boiler Room?
I haven't seen it in a long time.
Well, there's a scene where they're all watching Wall Street, quoting everything. Wall Street was like their godfather. right? That was their movie that they quoted everything. So anyway,
Did you see the sequel to Wall Street where they wussified? Wussified Gordon Gekko?
A little bit. I mean, that was with Shia LaBeouf.
He was a bad guy in the first one,
right?
And they kind of he had redemption, but I thought the way he played it was greed for a lack.
Well, we use that in your one of your training videos. So
sales, for a lack of a better word, is good. Sales works. Let me tell you something else. When you add a C to loser, you know what you get? That's right. You get closer. Now, you may be asking yourself, what are my qualifications? You want to know what my qualifications are? You see that watch? That watch costs more than your car. That's my qualifications.
Wow. Like I said, I'm pretty surprised by that one. I'm sure you won't be surprised by mine.
Let me guess. Wait a minute. Superhero movies?
No, foreign documentaries.
Starring superheroes.
Yeah, I was sci-fi fantasy for me is my favorite genre. And for me, I mean, we have such a different outlook on movies. Not all movies. I don't want to watch every movie I watch. I don't want it to be escapism. But one of the reasons why I love movies is because of escapism. And when you look at sci-fi and fantasy, it brings you to a place that you've never been to before, right? Where these, you know, like some of the movies we watch, some of the depressing ones, it's just so true to life that it's like, I don't want to see that. I want to be transported someplace. I want colorful characters. And it doesn't even have to be, it doesn't even have to be good sci-fi. I don't know if you remember, we saw a movie with Peter Strauss.
Yeah.
Something in the Forbidden Zone. You remember that?
It was 3D with Molly Ringwald.
It was an awful movie, but he was good in it.
I have it on Laserdisc.
You have it on Laserdisc?
I think I do.
Oh my God. Boy, how the mighty have fallen with him. Rich man, poor man of that movie.
Oh.
But
Nick Nolte came out all right though.
Yeah. Well, he did too. I mean, he did more TV stuff than movies, but Peter Strauss.
Do you remember Peter Strauss's best movie?
Jericho Mile.
Jericho Mile.
Loved
it. Directed by?
I have no idea.
Michael Mann.
I did not know that.
Early Michael Mann. Yep.
All I remember about, I mean, I remember everything about that movie, but the one scene that sticks in my head is when he throws a stopwatch against a brick wall and in slow motion it shatters after he broke the record. Love that movie. Yeah, and Peter Strauss could run too. I mean, he was a twig. But anyway,
yeah.
So for me, it's science fiction and fantasy. And you know me, my favorite movies are, you know, Raiders of the Lost Ark.
But that's not science fiction. You call that, that's part
fantasy,
of the genre?
Fantasy. I call that fantasy.
How is Raiders fantasy?
Let's see.
I get it, the big rolling ball and all that, but I mean,
not just that,
wouldn't you call that?
I would call it fantasy,
okay?
Because I mean, Ralph, the spirits come out of the ark and kill them.
I guess I don't, when I think of fantasy, I'm thinking Lord of the Rings and furry feet and all that.
I mean, fantasy is look, if you looked at the last Indiana Jones, it was aliens,
yeah,
okay? So to me, that's fantasy, yeah. So I love that. I mean, you could separate those categories because Lord of the Rings is definitely fantasy.
Subcategorize.
Yeah, it could be. But I look at them as kind of the same. It's like the superhero movies. Are those really science fiction? Or like Shazam, which I really liked.
Yeah, because it's not real.
Well, that's what I'm saying. So it could be science fiction. It could be fantasy. But okay. I like it because it's escapism. I even like, as a kid, I don't know if you ever watched them, but they used to have Creature Double Feature. You remember that, right? On Saturdays. But they used to show Flash Gordon. They used to show the series.
I don't remember Flash Gordon.
Yeah, and they were cheesy special effects. But I just remember as a kid being, oh, my God, this is so cool.
I liked Isis.
Zephyr winds that blow on high. Lift me high so I might fly.
She was cute. Shazam, I remember them driving around in a
camper.
In an RV or something.
Lightning bolt on the front. With Mentor.
All right, back to your films.
So anyway, so for me, look, there are standbys that I have. Superman, Star Wars, Raiders of the Lost Ark is my favorite movie of all time. But if you've never seen these movies, old, because you know me, I like the old movies. Metropolis, Fritz Lang, unbelievable what he was able to do back way, way back. Forbidden Planet, which was really one of the first big budget, serious science fiction movies.
Frank Drebin's in that.
Frank Drebin. That's right. Leading man. And it was they used Robbie the Robot, who is in
That's all about your id.
That's right. It's based on Shakespeare's The Tempest, in case you were interested. And Walt Disney, for the only time they did it, they partnered with them to do the animation for the monster that was invisible, the invisible id. Actually, they did all the animation, the ray guns, the electrical field and stuff like that. So that's a great, The Thing from Another World, you know, I love that movie. But
you've only seen John Carpenter's The Thing once.
Yeah, I just found it's one of those movies that there are scenes in it I really like, but there's a lot of disturbing scenes in it that I'm just not gung-ho to see.
As a couple movies I want to ask you about,
yeah,
if you've seen them, that are science fiction, but go ahead. There's a couple specifically I want to ask you about.
Well, no, I'm curious about you because, you know, everyone knows, because I post stuff all the time. You know how I feel about science fiction and what I like. I'm kind of curious about you. I don't even know if you like the genre. But
I like movies like have you ever seen Sunshine? Danny Boyle's Sunshine?
No. Is that with they're near the sun or something? Or
they have to go to the sun. They have to recharge the sun. They got to shoot a nuclear thing into the sun because Earth is cold. And they send a crew out to and it's a typical story where just like Prometheus and Ale, any movie where, oh, we got a beeper signal, we got to go rescue. Even 2001 or 2010 with Roy Scheider, same thing. Some blip happens, they got to help somebody else. Sunshine, Event Horizon, you've probably never seen that.
Lawrence Fishburne, isn't he in that? Yeah.
Yep. Have you seen it?
Yeah, but a long time ago.
Yeah. So, I mean, I kind of like Alien, of course, is a science fiction horror. You could put that in a bunch of genres.
You remember the movie? You turned me on to this. It starred Michael Nuri, and it was about an
alien. Yeah, The Hidden.
The Hidden, that's the one, with Kyle, the guy from Twin Peaks.
Yep.
I really liked that movie, and that was a low-budget science fiction movie.
Well, that was kind of an Alien ripoff, I think.
It was good.
Yeah.
Yeah, but no, it wasn't even. The alien would go in your mouth and control.
Well, I mean, but I think it came out after Alien. Michael Nuri had just come off of Flashdance. I think even if you listen to the Hidden commentary, he was fighting with the director the whole time. He's just one of these guys that just has to always, unlike what we were talking about, Galaxy Quest, where everybody was on the same team.
It was a love fest.
They were talking to the writer. I want to make sure I do the right thing for you. I think he was the opposite. The other thing I learned from the Hidden commentary is the director talked about Kyle MacLachlan. When you meet him in person, he looks like an average dude. Like he looks like anybody walking up. The minute you put the camera on him, he said, the minute I looked in the viewfinder and you look at him through the camera lens, he's a movie star.
Really?
And there are people who, the camera, like Jack Nicholson, there are people who understand camera angles and all that. And he said, Kyle MacLachlan's one of those guys that once that camera goes on, you realize why he was a movie star. Then he did Showgirls, and I think it all went downhill. But back to The Hidden, yes, Hidden was a really nice, a good science fiction film.
I like that. And it was a low budget. It wasn't a big budget. It was a great story.
Yeah. I guess I enjoyed Star Wars. I'm not going to, the first three. I actually liked a couple of the newer ones that have come out, specifically
Rogue One.
Rogue One, I thought was fantastic.
Yeah, but that was that wasn't part of the trilogy.
No, I understand that. Yeah. But
I liked it. I didn't like any of the other ones. Actually, was the best one out of the three. I mean,
which
Empire,
one?
Empire Strikes Back.
Yes, it was.
It was the best movie out of the three.
It was.
But I could watch those movies I could watch all the time. Although now that you watch Star Wars now, I still like it a lot, but it's a lot slower than I remember it being, where Empire, I thought, was faster paced, better story, but I still love it.
I still think he kind of, again, we talk about lightning in a bottle all the time. I mean, you got to believe that those people, when they were doing Star Wars, were like, what are we doing here? Harrison Ford and Alec Guinness is like, what the?
Well, I know the British ridiculous crew felt that way. They had no idea what the hell they were doing.
Well, how could they know that? That's, again, it's lightning in a bottle. They just hit it.
Well, of course,
that's why he ruined the next three, because he just got into himself. And Because he did that one with Robert De Niro. Not De Niro, I'm sorry. Duvall, XX17, what is that one?
Oh, THX17.
You know, the one he did. Yeah. Now, do you like Logan's Run?
I love Logan's Run.
Okay. And yeah. I mean, so science fiction, there's a lot of Planet of the Apes. That's science fiction, right?
Oh, yeah. Well, fantasy, science fiction.
Okay. I mean, well, again, yeah, that's apes running the world.
Have
that's
you
fantasy.
Seen any, like, have you seen Metropolis?
Yeah.
How'd you like Metropolis?
I mean, you know, it's again, it's black and white, right? So it's.
How about Things to Come? You ever seen that?
Nope.
I mean, you look at how old those movies are and what they were able to do visually.
Yes.
And I'm not saying it holds up, but it's still pretty amazing. I sit there and go, how the heck could they have done that back then? Where now everything is, you know, computer and all this stuff.
Well, a lot of movies I look back and go, I don't know. I honestly, in my business, I don't know how we pulled off the stuff we did before all this technology kicked
in. It is pretty amazing because if you look at Star Wars, the original, it's all practical effects.
Right.
All models, right? In fact, they had to invent cameras to make the ships move.
Well, they're the ones that came. They're the ones who came up with don't move the model, move the camera. Right.
Exactly.
ILM came up with that.
Industrial Light Magic came from Star Wars, and then he was able to fund his own movies, which because the studio kept wanting to shut him down because they didn't think he knew what he was doing, and he kind of admitted that too. He had a breakdown during it, but. You know, when they were lining up around the block.
They did the same thing to Spielberg. You know, they had to send sex workers to Amity Island.
No, they're hookers, Ralph. Well,
they're not
on
hookers.
The vineyard, they're
hookers are people who make rugs. Okay, fish. Those are hookers.
No, hookers, it's fish. It's, you know, that's right. What they call
and,
them in the vineyard.
Fish, hookers, and rug makers, people who sell their body for money, they're sex workers. I just want everybody to know that. So they had to send sex workers to Martha's Vineyard because Spielberg was stressed out and so Universal was ready to take the movie away from him. So these guys, all of them, believe me, Martin Scorsese, probably he had breakdowns in half of his films that he was doing, but look what they come up with. I mean,
you ever see Silent Running?
Yes.
How'd you like that?
That's Bruce Dern, right?
Yeah.
It was good. I like Roger Corman's, all his stupid science fiction stuff he did.
Well, there's one I just watched, Battle Beyond the Stars,
right.
With Richard Thomas and Robert Vaughn.
It's
a remake of The Magnificent.
How about Flash Gordon, the Queen, Flash Gordon, one.
Love it, with Sam Jones.
Science fiction is a huge, like, just huge.
So you do like science fiction.
Yeah, 100%, yeah.
That's interesting.
I think it's the fantasy, like...
You don't like the... Well, you haven't seen The Lord of the Rings.
I have to watch it.
Believe you haven't seen that. Just from a filmmaking standpoint.
I know. I dated someone who said to me, you haven't seen The Lord of the Rings? I go, no. I can't do this.
It split you up?
Yeah. That's the story I'm going with. That's the story I'm going with.
Oh, yeah. It wasn't anything you did. Anyway, wow. So, all right. So let me throw out something else at you. Cause you threw me with the finance stuff. So let me throw another genre at you and ask, I want to ask you, pick a couple of movies that, you would recommend, musicals.
Oh Christ. Okay.
Well, listen, I know you're going to say Grease.
Grease, right? Is fantastic.
Yeah.
Hair.
Oh, Treat Williams. Milo Forman.
Yeah, name some musicals, I'll tell you. I mean, I don't hate musicals. I can't wait to see Steven Spielberg's West Side Story. West Side Story, I love. The original.
It's like remaking Jaws.
I don't know. There's something about what he's going to do to it that I think is going to be fantastic.
I mean, the only thing I think that would be good, they're going to be able to, you know, West Side Story filmed in New York, which is something at the time was very rare, but they only filmed so much there. That to me would be really cool if they could film on location.
I think they did. I'm not 100% sure.
But I just look at that movie. Why would you want to remake it? It's such a good movie. Like I said, it's like remaking Jaws. I just don't know.
I loved all that jazz.
Roy Scheider.
Right. I know we make a big joke out of Singing in the Rain.
We don't make a joke out of it. I would never make a joke about that movie.
I know it's beloved. I get it.
It's the best American movie musical of all time.
How about Phantom of the Opera, the one Paul Williams is in?
Phantom of Paradise.
That one.
Yeah.
Queen, Bohemian Rhapsody, I thought it's a great karaoke movie.
Yeah, you know, my feeling on that movie is I thought the movie was okay.
Yeah.
I thought he was spectacular. Actually, the guys in the band.
If you actually listen to the movie, listen to the dialogue, it's like, what the? This is ridiculous.
No. And they also did Revisionist History with Queen.
Well, they did. They totally.
But he was, listen. Like, on YouTube, they show the clip of that concert side by side.
Oh, no. They copied that. But that Sacha Baron Cohen was supposed Sacha Baron Cohen was supposed to play Freddie Mercury.
Really?
In a biopic. That would have been midgets holding heroin and cocaine at the parties and giving guys handies because they're walking by a little. I mean, little people. I don't mean midgets. I mean, little people.
I mean, you're in the 70s.
No, those parties were like, I used to read articles about the Queen parties that they used to have. And in this PG-13 thing, everybody's
that was
like,
the thing. They said they cleaned it up quite a bit. But you know what? I didn't even care because his performance was.
I get it. No, amazing. And I love. You know, that I'm a huge Queen fan, so I just couldn't. Yeah. I love the music.
The music was great.
So,
and the fact that he did, I mean, it was his voice and a Freddie Mercury impersonator, and they combined the voices. So,
did you see the Elton John biopic? I never saw that one.
I didn't. You know, after seeing that one, I'm like, well, what are they going to? Did you like it?
I didn't see it. I was thinking the same thing. I saw the Queen one, and I just.
I did hear the kid, Tyler, what's his name?
No, he's a kid from the Umbrella.
From Kingsman, the Umbrella guy, yeah. The Kingsman. He did all his own singing, and I heard he was very good in it.
Yeah, he was good. So what I heard, he was good.
Yeah, I mean.
I mean, what other musicals have been out that.
Well, see, for me, it's not anything current. I mean, I like old, like Bye Bye Birdie, I love, because I love Anne Margaret. The Music Man for me is right up there because of Robert Preston. I actually really like. And I got it on Blu-ray, My Fair Lady. But I'm disappointed that Audrey Hepburn didn't do her own singing. But she was great in it. And Rex Harrison. By the way, that was a musical where Rex Harrison couldn't dub his songs because he did it different every time. So it was one of the first times they built in microphones. So he sang live on the stage. And he was really good in it. And that was, you know, the old story. They wanted Cary Grant to do it. And Cary Grant said, if you don't hire Rex Harrison to do it, I won't even go see the movie. So, yeah. So, you know, I like those old, because they don't make them like that. They just, I know that sounds so cliche, but they don't make musicals like that.
You know anymore. What it is? You come from a stage background.
Yeah, that's true.
And
I've done Grease a couple of times.
Right. Those things look staged to me, like those old
and
films.
They are. That
so now
on that error, that's the way they were, right?
On one of the podcasts we had to do, we did the ladies' choice where our significant others would bring a film, and Debbie wanted to do Sound of Music.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh my God, I have to. And you know what? I love that film.
Yeah.
And part of it is it's in the DNA. It's songs that you just knew I knew every song, and it made me want to watch the film. And I really enjoyed that. And that's an old school musical, like The King and I. Remember, I loved The King and I when it came out. So I go to musicals. I saw, you know, Magic Mike is kind of a musical, but with naked guys dancing around. That was fun.
Did
you ever see Magic Mike?
No.
Oh, it's actually great. It's great. Yeah.
Mike really likes it.
Yeah. Yeah. I was like there were three guys in the whole movie theater watching that. And it was great.
Did you get dragged there by a young lady?
No, my Jen and I went, and I had no problem going. Because it's what's his name?
Soderbergh. Well, you got man crushes anyway, right?
Who's that man guy in that?
I can't believe I'm drawing a blank on his name. He was in 21 Drum Street too.
Right. No.
Great. I
he's good. He's great. He's great. But I know, no. My man crushes are old guys.
Well,
Kevin Costner, Brad Pitt.
It's funny, Kevin Costner. I just watched The Untouchables.
That's great.
He looks like a baby in that movie.
It's so good. He's got a new movie out with Diane Lane.
It looks good.
By the way, have you ever seen City on Fire that she did back in the day? I never saw
City on Fire.
I think that's what it's called. Walter Hill did it.
Oh no, no.
Michael Perret, Diane Lane.
I love that movie.
Diane Lane has not aged. I know she
was Superman. She was like 18 when she made that movie.
She's adorable. And she and Kevin Costner just did a film together.
Yeah. They're
I Want It Back or something.
But yeah. When I was watching Untouchables, and frankly, I watched it because of Sean Connery. And I was like, wow.
He was good. Did he got the Oscar for that one?
Yeah,
he
was great in that movie. And the movie was good. The movie was awesome. The way it was filmed, the old Chicago and De Niro.
No, I agree.
De Niro was great in it.
Did I tell you the story when Belle and I we took that train ride to Chicago?
Yeah.
I told you about so it's a 17-hour train ride.
Yeah.
It was like Amtrak had this deal for like $34.
Oh, wow.
Round trip. So I said, Bella, we got on a train Friday night. We get there. So we're getting a train to Chicago. Saturday, we spend 4 hours in Chicago. Then we get on a 24-hour train back to Maryland. But while we're at the Chicago train station.
You're at the stairs.
And I said to Bella, and we're sitting in this area that we're waiting for our train. So I said, I got to walk around. I got to find where the staircase is. So I walk all over the damn thing. Come back. And I'll never forget. I turn around. I'm sitting there with Bella waiting for a train. I turn around and the stairway is just literally right behind me. And I'll show pictures, but I took a ton of pictures.
Oh, you did?
Of me leaning on the rail, you know, because it's that's yeah,
I went there and I was looking for the locations, you know, a couple scenes where they shot when they go from the police station to
it's
that street right there. Cause the architecture is the same. I mean, it looks, you know, but that
did you ever listen to a podcast called I Was There? This guy, Matt, I can't think of his last name.
No,
he would talk about famous scenes in movies, and he would find an actor who was not the main actor, but just somebody who happened to be in the scene. Right. So he found the woman, you know, the woman who's got the baby.
Yeah.
He found her and he spent a whole hour talking about how they filmed that scene. And they made that scene up on the fly.
They didn't know
what they had. And Andy Garcia, you know that scene where he slides and shoots?
Yeah.
He says to Brian De Palma, he goes, you know, I played baseball as a kid. I know how to slide. I think this would be kind of cool. And they just came up with all that stuff on the fly.
Well, it was also based on the Battleship Potemkin.
I understand that. I was going to mention that when you were talking about Metropolis, that's the kind of movie that I watched about editing and stuff.
Well, I saw that.
That was the first time people started, you know, editing.
I took a film class in college and we saw that. But that's interesting. Yeah, that's good. So what musical, based on your taste, would you recommend? Give me one musical you'd recommend.
Grease. No, I mean, honestly, All That Jazz.
Ah, okay. I loved it.
All That Jazz, I think, is a tour de force.
That's based on Bob Fosse.
Right, obviously. And he directed it.
Yeah.
Did he direct that?
Yeah, and Roy Scheider was fantastic.
Roy Scheider's fantastic. Jessica Lange plays Death.
Death, yeah.
Yes, I would recommend All That Jazz.
And if you like, you know me, I'm old school. So I would recommend, even though they kind of messed it up, it's not like the Broadway show, but I would recommend Bye Bye Birdie, because Anne Margaret, that was her first big role. Oh, she was awesome in that. And I love Dick Van Dyke too. That's a part I've always wanted to play, Dick Van Dyke's part in that. I would love to play that. But anyway,
Bye Bye Birdie? Is that, that's not Elvis, right?
Well, it's Conway Twitty. It's based on Elvis though. So Elvis, when Elvis went in the army, the play is based on Elvis going into the army.
What do you mean it's Conway Twitty?
The actor, Conrad Birdie.
Oh,
instead
okay.
of Elvis, his character's name is Conrad Birdie. They wanted to have Elvis in it, but his manager, the colonel, wouldn't let him try out for it. He would have been great.
But he threw up in the trumpet in Commitment, so.
Yeah, exactly. But it's a good movie. It's uplifting.
Commitments is a good musical.
What is?
Commitments.
I love the Commitments. I love that. That's a soundtrack I listen to all the time.
Check our webpage for Commitments.
Yeah. A lot of hits on that too. A lot of people on Facebook anyway, talk about how much they love the movie. They apparently don't want to leave comments on YouTube.
You blame them.
But they're leaving it on Facebook, which is good. That's okay. Right. Okay. So listen, I want to do this again and I'm going to pick, I'm going to give you a little time though, because I only told you what kind of the topic was going to be.
Right.
But here's what I want you to think about for next week. I want to talk about.
I got homework.
I want to talk about westerns.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So I want you to think about that now.
That's a good genre.
Yeah, it's a great genre, and it's it started very American, but it turned into international pretty quickly. So I want to
talk. Well, I think they all stole from each other.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So, and we're also planning on next, if we can't get the whole family on next Friday, which is the Friday before Thanksgiving, we want to do a whole family Thanksgiving podcast with Patty, Marie, and my brother Steve to kind of kick off Thanksgiving. If we can't get them Friday, we'll do it the following Friday. So the Western theme will be either next Friday or the Friday after Thanksgiving.
So what are we going to talk about if we bring the whole family?
About our Thanksgivings, and I want to show, because remember, in 1980, we had a video camera. No one had video.
Right.
I want to show some of the stuff that we shot because it's probably your family. I mean, you sit around the table talking ragtime the whole time, but we got it on video thanks to my dad. Okay.
Right.
So I think it'd be funny to talk about our Thanksgiving and holidays in general. Some of us embrace the holidays. Some of us didn't enjoy the holidays. So I think it might be fun to talk about that with our other siblings. So I'll try to confirm if they can get on it. And it might expand our audience too, although some of them probably wouldn't even let anyone know they did.
Are they going to come on after I mentioned some family secrets as Marie and Patty? Which I didn't say what they thought I said, but...
We're going to have to put a little filter on it because whatever you say, right, you say something here, Marie brings it here.
Right.
Okay?
So she did rant that way up.
She's a bomb dropper. All right. And she gets us in a lot of trouble. So we just got a little filter. But I think what we should do is we should each, before we get on, we should have a couple of drinks. And then while we're on, we should be drinking.
Yeah, I agree with that.
That way everyone.
That's Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
But no politics.
No, we don't do politics here.
Well, if we're drinking, you still no politics.
No, I will not listen. I will not do politics. I'm telling you now. This is my one respite from that. Okay. And I want to keep it that way.
I just want you drinking politics.
Now, sometime down the road, Ralph, if nobody watches this show, we might eventually have to get into it. I think it would be entertaining because you and I couldn't be more opposite.
Right. And nobody's watching anyway. So who cares?
So, but I hope it doesn't come to that. Cause really I want one place where it's not part
Maria's
of
Maria's watching these.
Oh, what's that?
My friend Maria.
Yeah.
I'm just saying she's watching these.
What does that mean?
It just means somebody's watching.
Oh, okay.
Other than mom and dad.
Tim's watching them too.
Who?
Tim.
Shout out to Tim.
Oh, Tim. Thanks for watching, Tim.
Tim. We will, if people message us or put a comment, we'll shout them out, right? I have no problem.
Oh, I will. Absolutely.
Yeah. Kidding.
Actually, Mark Tarbox is the one who talked about we give away spoilers on our other podcast.
We fixed that. Thank you, Mark.
I know. That was good. I think that's good. And that was good feedback, too, because some of the movies we pick are obscure and people have never seen them. So that's okay.
That's right.
Like Spitfire Grill.
That's right. We got a good one coming up. Phantasm.
Phantasm. It's not Phantasm. It's Phantasm.
Phantasm. Is that fantasy, science fiction, or horror? What is that?
That's fantasy. That's fantasy.
Right. Yeah.
And it's low budget fantasy too.
Right.
So, all right, Ralph, that's it, man.
All right.
I hope you have a great weekend. We'll see you on the other podcast Tuesday. And everyone, again, I know I'm begging, please subscribe, hit the notification button, share it. We need to expand our audience. We really do appreciate you watching. Or listening, if you're listening on any of our streaming services.
Right.
And I hope you have a great weekend and get ready for Thanksgiving, okay?
All right. Stay safe. Everybody stay safe.
Take care.